This is how we always start the Facebook feed,
this
though,
is Instagram.
Because we're always screwy.
Say what's up to Instagram.
What's up, Instagram? Show Instagram all the friendly faces that we have here.
60,000 people watching all at once. Well, maybe not quite 60.
Okay.
Hold on 1 second. Already up.
Facebook literally gets to see my face right now.
Okay, you are good to go.
We're
sir.
Good to go?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And this is kind of weird because it's both live and on video, so we kind of will be talking to the camera and you guys. So, but thanks for coming. We're super stoked to have Devin Lansing Gilbert here. Arguably some of the best fishermen in the whole country. We had the opportunity to go and watch their new DVD, their new film, last night, and we've got links for that all over our site. You can find that at Tactical Fly Fisher too. But anyway, I won't babble on too much, but we're going to have them demonstrate some of the flies they talked about last night. And this is a Q&A session as well, so if you have any questions about anything, you can ask them, and they'll be able to answer probably 87% of your questions. See, I told you I'd come up with statistics. All right, so who's up first?
Well done, Sasquatch.
You guys can pass. Okay, thanks for joining us, both the in-house audience and all the streamers out there. My name is Devin Olson. So like Cheech was talking about, we just released a new film called Modern Nymphing. Lance and I and Gilbert did a collaborative effort to try and bring the techniques that Lance and I have been using as members of Fly Fishing Team USA for the last decade or so, maybe to a little bit wider audience. So within that film, we do a lot of instructional Euro-nymphing type stuff, but at the end we also have a confidence flies section. So tonight, as we're tying, we're going to take some of those flies from the confidence flies section and show you how to tie them here in person. I'm going to start with a fly called the Blowtorch. And I've just got a size 14 nymph hook here. This is a Hanuk 230, but whatever your favorite nymph hook is, feel free to use that. And I have a slotted copper tungsten bead. This is a 2.8 millimeter bead. You could also go with a 3.3 on this size 14 to make it a little bit oversized for some extra weight. This fly is a really cool fly. When we were in the Czech Republic for the World Championships back in 2014, I think it was, our guide there was trying to teach us how to catch these chubs that were in the river, because the chubs actually counted in the competition that time. And one of the flies they used for these chubs were tag nymphs. And tag nymphs have become really popular all across Europe and starting to get a little more popular here. But tag nymphs are really popular for grayling as well as trout in Europe. And so this was this is my take basically on the fly that the guide showed us. Changed a few of the materials and the color scheme, but it was really effective for me during the championship, both for the brown trout and the rainbows that we were catching, but also for some grayling and the occasional chub when I came across them. This is a variation I like for our home waters here. So we'll get going. I've got just some 15/1000ths lead wire here, and I'm going to go ahead and make three wraps. And really, it adds a little bit of extra weight, but actually what this lead wire is also going to do is prop the bead up for me and make sure that it jams it to the front. So I've made those three wraps. I've turned the vise upside down so that the bead gets a little bit offset. You can see that it's not quite in line there, and you get more weight to the top of the hook this way. It kind of forms a quasi jig type effect where it'll sometimes invert the fly this way. Go ahead and put your thread behind those lead wraps and tie it in, and then just do a couple wraps over the lead to set it in tight. And I always just break off that lead. And bring your thread to the back of the hook there. And where did I, there's my scissors. And I'm now going to use for the tag this globe right. This happens to be number 5, which is a fluorescent flame orange. But you can choose all sorts of different tag colors. Usually orange and or pink are my favorites. And there's lots of different shades and within the globe right lineup of oranges and pinks. So I've taken a single strand of globe right and I've chopped it into thirds here so that you have 3 strands. It's not a 4-strand floss like you might find in some flosses. So I've just combined all the strands here to make 3 strands. You don't want to have, at least I don't like to have too bushy of a hot spot at the back. I just want this to be a small little trigger that's not overwhelming, but does give the fish something to look at the back of the fly. So I've evened up the tips on this floss. I'm going to go ahead and make a pinch wrap kind of up right behind the lead, lock that in with a couple of turns, then just slide the floss back as you make a couple of wraps to the back, and that'll keep you from even having to trim off any of the excess and just hide that seamlessly right into the body. Now I've got some micro flashaboo or sulky, whatever you've got at hand. Just some pearl tinsel, extra small, something along that line. I'm going to tie that in on the near side of the hook. So a little pinch wrap there. And just a couple of wraps to get it locked in. Now I'm taking some 5X tippet, and this is going to form my counter rib. That tinsel can be a little bit delicate and get chopped up by a fish's tooth or two within a few fish, so I like to counter rib it. So some 5X is going in on the far side of the fly here, and I'm just holding them both as I wrap that thread towards the back of the fly. So now I've got that in at the back, and I have some peacock black hairline ice dub here. And I'm just going to dub a nice little thin noodle. Probably about right for this size fly. Okay. So just wrap that dubbing up. You don't have to form much of a taper or anything with this fly. As you can see, it doesn't really fit in the category of being anything imitative. It's crazy and it looks like absolutely nothing you'd ever find on a river. So being that it's an attractor, don't be trying to imitate anything anatomical, obviously. Just keep it nice and thin. Thin to win is what a lot of Europeans tend to say with their flies. I like that phrase. Makes it so you think, you know, don't get your flies any bulkier than they have to be. So I'm taking that micro pearl tinsel. And if I'm looking at the front of the hook, I'm going to go counterclockwise with it. So since it's tied near to me, I'm going to go under the fly first. And 3 wraps is fine on this size of hook. And then I'm just going to counter it with that 5X also 3 times. And we're good to go there. All right, so there's a couple of things you can use for your hackle here. A simple hen hackle worked just fine. I have a video of this out there on YouTube where that's what I'm using in it. But tonight I figured I'd show you the other way that I do this fly a lot, which is with CDC. So in order to prepare the feather when I'm using CDC, I tend to like to stroke it first and get those fibers out close to perpendicular. And then as you're making a wrap with the CDC, towards the end, if you have both sides of the feather on there, a lot of those fibers are going to get trapped under your last thread wrap, and it ends up putting a whole chunk of fibers all in one spot where you finished the fly or where you tied it down. So I take and I just cut off one side of the lower half of the feather, just trim it nice and close to the coil. And you'll see that about half the fibers are missing off that bottom end. So then I take and stroke those fibers back again, and I've just got the tip facing forward here. Go ahead and lock it in and trim it off. And then you want to make maybe three wraps with this, enough to get some fibers in there, but not so much that it ends up having enough that they get trapped. You want each of them, you just don't want it to be too bushy. So actually I did two wraps there. This is a pretty large and decent feather that had a lot of fibers, so it also depends upon the individual CDC feather you've got and how full it is. One thing I forgot to do on this that a lot of times I will do is I will put another slight ball of dubbing right behind that CDC feather, because I try and, even though it a lot of times looks better if you have those fibers right down near the shank of the hook or the body of the fly, you'll get more movement out of it if you prop it out a little bit. So I will use a little bit of a ball of dubbing right behind the hackle to prop it out sometimes. But of course, being that we're live, I just forgot to do it.
Wait, we'll rewind.
Yeah, I know. It doesn't quite work that way, right? All right, so I'm going to
edit it.
Where's your edit on the fly software? Come on. All right, so I just had some iron gray ADOT for the main body of the fly there. I'm now switching to some 14-0 Vivas fluorescent orange, and I'm just going to finish off the fly with a little bit of a hot spot there. So you can see this fly has plenty of triggers, and that you got some flashy pearl tinsel, you've got orange front and back. You could also choose to do this with some dubbing, like some ice dubbing or something like that. And that's more than I often would use it there. It slid back a little bit. I try and keep that hot spot smaller than that most of the time. But that's another reason to put that dubbing ball behind the CDC, is it helps you prevent that thread from rolling back over the CDC hackle as well. Okay, so I'm just going to finish this. A lot of times, to increase some durability, I'll just put some super glue on the thread before I finish it. Make a couple of wraps with that to lock it in. And a couple turn whip finish. And really what I often strive for is just to make the most durable fly possible. And
hey, Devin, not to interrupt you, but sure. I've got questions coming through on the live stream here.
Mm-hmm.
Is that the presentation 2000 or 3000?
This is the 2000.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right, cool. I'll be interrupting you.
No, that's fine.
Throughout the night.
There was one other question, which was, do you prefer copper or gold beads?
This one's a copper bead. That's the one that I tend to go to most often, but a gold bead is a great substitute for this as well. You could even try silver. There's a lot of Europeans that would tend to use a light metallic pink bead on this type of fly as well. So the other thing you're going to notice, obviously, is that the CDC fibers are totally uneven, and one side's really long, one side's really short, right? We don't want that. Now, you could just take your scissors and snip it to length, but that'd make the fly look pretty hokey. So a lot of times what I do is I just take and pinch the fly in my right hand, and then go and break those CDC fibers off with my fingernails on my left hand. And obviously, if you're using some sort of chicken hackle, hen, whatever, you wouldn't be able to do that very easily. But with CDC, the fibers actually cut pretty well, especially if you have a slight bit of fingernail to be able to do it. So what you end up with is a CDC hackle that is trimmed to length that way, but without making it flush like you would with scissors. So that's it. That's the finished blowtorch. Not my finest blowtorch ever, but that's okay. make the hot spot up. It'll catch fish, that's for sure. This is definitely one of my favorite. It's one of my favorite attractors, especially on freestone rivers. It seems to have pulling power, where a lot of times you're searching through a riffle and you might have to hit them on the head with something imitative, but this will pull fish from their line and really get them to grab.
Hey, Devin, question, why a slotted bead on a regular hook?
Okay, the other thing I didn't explain, right at the beginning of that fly, I showed you that I propped the bead up a little bit with the lead wire, both to offset it, so you can hopefully get that fly to invert without tying it on a jig hook. But also, a lot of my flies are tied on these barbless hooks that, I don't know how well you can see it here, pretty well, that have this upturned point. Now, that upturned point is great for holding fish, but it takes up a little bit of the gap of that hook to grab fish. So by having that slotted bead and then propping it up, I can actually remove some of the gap that the bead is also going to take up and maintain that gap to be able to hook fish and hold them. So really, it's a gap maintenance and an offset reason for having that slotted bead. And originally, when I did a lot of weighing of different tungsten beads, and depending upon the tungsten beads you get, this may or may not be the case, but a lot of the ones that I had at the time when I was, a couple years ago when I was tying a lot of these and other flies, the slotted beads ended up being a little bit heavier than the countersunk beads that I had. So I also got more weight out of the slotted bead than I was getting out of the countersunk bead. So lots of different reasons why I might choose the slotted over the countersunk. And it's gotten to the point now where I just pretty much use slotted for everything because of those. Okay. So next fly here is super simple, super effective. And I have absolutely fallen in love with this style of pattern over the last couple of years. This is a style of fly called a perdigone. And these flies were originated by the Spanish competitors. I've talked to several of them. They all fight about who, of course, was the originator of this. And there's a lot of a lot of opinions on how old this pattern is, whatever. Who cares, right? This is it's basically a mayfly type nymph imitation. You can go on some Spanish websites and they'll have like 80 different variations of this exact same fly in all sorts of different colors for every condition you could ever think of. But I had a friend who, when I was living in California a couple of years ago, my good friend Luis, I actually was in a boat with him at the national championships back in Basalt in 2013 or 14, whenever that was. And we became good friends because he actually ended up being in Berkeley and I moved to Sacramento to work for a year, and we fished every other week together. And he was fishing this style of pattern all the time. Every time we went fishing, this is pretty much what was on his line. Didn't matter where we were at, every river, he was always fishing this. And he was catching a lot of fish. And for the longest time, I couldn't understand why you would want to fish this pattern. It has no legs, no movement. It's just basically UV resin or epoxy over thread or flash or whatever in a mayfly shape. But really what it boils down to is when you're European nymphing a lot of times, but you want to still be able to use a small fly with not very much weight but get it to depth, then you got to have a fly that doesn't have a lot of appendages that'll slow its sink rate. So this fly is designed specifically to accomplish that. So we'll get into it here. I've got some, let's see, 010 lead wire here, and you could do 015 on this as well, but you might get a little bit too bulbous front end of the thorax. Again, we're going to try and stay thin to win here. And I've got a silver slotted bead on just a regular standard size 16 hook. This is another Hanick 230. And I'm going to go ahead and make those three wraps again. And then invert that vise, get that slotted bead to offset, and then jam it forward. And I've gone back to just that same iron gray thread here. Any dark thread is what you want here. I'm actually going to be doing a different variation that I've been fishing just since this year's World Championship too. This is a variation that a Spanish youth team, a competitor in the Youth World Championships the year before, just tore up the Eagle River with. And I've been fishing it since this year's championship. And the funny thing is, it didn't work very well for the championship for me this year, but on the rivers that he used it on. But I've been fishing it at home in Oregon and here in Utah when I've come to visit my family over Thanksgiving and stuff. And it's been a great color variation for me. You can tie this fly in any number of color schemes, but this is a fun one that's an attractor version but also imitative in shape. And I caught a few of my fish when we went fishing here on the Provo on this pattern today. This exact color variation as well. So I've just attached that thread, broken off that lead wire, wrapped it back again. And I've got some coque de leon. Since it's a Spanish fly, I have the real good stuff here, straight from Leon. It's actually really nice. My buddy Luis, that I was telling you about, he knows all the Spanish breeders, so I had some fun connections there. And these are actually bird feathers that he left me before he went back to Spain when we were in California. So, fun stuff. And I believe this is a dark Pardo. I still don't know all what the difference is between all their color variations. He sends me all these colors with these different labels, and they all look pretty much the same to me. So a dark Pardo works really good. Barred speckled Achancado, black speckled Corzuno, any of them would work.
Why use coque de leon instead of regular chicken?
Good question, Lance. So coque de leon has some kind of special properties, if you ask me. First, it's known for having really good sheen. So it's got some nice glint in the water. Second, as you can see from this feather, the modeling on these feathers is spectacular. So you get that variegated speckled look that, you know, if you're looking for something that's natural, you certainly have that. And then the fibers themselves are pretty stiff, despite being on saddle pieces. So they make good tailing fibers that remain separate and stiff instead of kind of bushy. And they're thin as well. Okay, so let's back up. I've got three fibers here. You can do four as well. I don't like to do any more than four. You know, none of your mayflies out there have any more than three tails, so it doesn't make sense to put six or seven fibers on here. And I've just kind of stroked those fibers perpendicularly on the feather so that it lines the tips up, and then you cut them off so your tips are already lined up. And I'm going to make a pinch wrap here. Just a couple to lock it in and go to the front. And then I've got some UV blue crystal flash. Other favorites for this fly, Luis would fish a version. He had this flashback that he liked that was this shade of orange. When I've looked at his original flies that he gave me and tried to match it with some crystal flash, because it's a lot easier to tie this fly with crystal flash than cutting out a strip of a flashback. The fluorescent fire orange crystal flash is really good to match his original variation. I also really like tying this fly with just peacock with a dark thread under it. That makes a great betis imitation. It's flashy, but dark, like you'd find on a lot of betas. But for this one, being that it's a little bit of an attractor as well as an imitator, at least silhouette-wise, I've just got that UV blue crystal flash. And wrap it back. Try not to wrap over the wraps you've already anchored the coque de leon in with, because it'll slide them down and split them around at a different angle that you don't want. So you want to go exactly right to the tie-in point. And then I'm just going to build a slight bit of a taper so that I don't have a big bump right at that lead. And then you can just wrap this by hand. And usually I'll wrap it by hand for the first turn or two so I have really accurate placement. But then once I've gotten those turns in place, I just go ahead and use the vise to spin it out. And there again, try and keep that little bit of taper. You can kind of go back and forth to get the taper that you want. And go ahead and tie it off the front. And just like the last pattern, I'm going to change thread colors right here at the head. So just give it a quick little two-turn wood finish and go to that same fluorescent orange. Now, one thing I should have done is tie this fly first, because the next step requires a little bit of drying time between, but make your little hot spot there. And then all you do for the next step is just take some black nail polish. And if you look at most of the perdigones that are out there, they almost all have this dark wing pad. And if you look at an actual Betis nymph, you will typically see that they have dark wing pads right before they hatch as well. Now this, I'm going to go ahead and go as light as I can on this nail polish to try and see if I can get it to dry really quick.
Hey, Devin, while you're waiting, why not on a jig hook?
So lots of people are going to tie this fly on a jig hook, and that's totally fine. This specific hook right here is just my go-to hook for holding fish. As a competitor, we're constantly reevaluating every last piece of gear to make sure not only that we hook the most fish that we can, but we also get the most fish to the net. Because a fish that we hook but lose doesn't do us a bit of good in the scoring end of things. And so I play around with hooks all the time. And for the last couple of years, as I've messed around with different hook models, this Hanek 230 has just kind of risen to the top for me for being a hook that I have the highest hook to landed ratio on when it comes to fish. So really, that's it. The jig hook certainly has an advantage in that it's totally inverted. You're probably going to have maybe a little less hookup with the bottom that way. But I found that with a lot of jig hooks, I was just losing more fish than I was with this this hook right here.
Got you a question, Devin.
Sure.
So a perdigon is essentially the same shape no matter what you do with it, but there's infinite color variabilities that you could go with. What process do you go through when you come to watering your trees and you're trying to, do you have a color that you just like the most? Are you trying to match a specific insect, water clarity? Like what kind of factors are you thinking about?
So first things first is water clarity typically. Although I've been surprised a lot of times by catching fish on perdigons that were ultra bright in really clear water. For the most part, if it's a more turbid water, I'm going to go to a flashier type variation. I fish like most people are familiar with Lance's Rainbow Warrior. I fish a version of this that's basically like a Rainbow Warrior. And that's been really good for me in rivers that have a little bit of color to them. I've actually caught a lot of steelhead on that fly. So that's another great one. If it's a place where you would normally fish a Rainbow Warrior, put on a pearl version of this. If you have actually a lot of mayflies around and you might be trying to imitate one of them, you know, pick a color that's close to the mayflies that are hatching. So if I've got Betis around, I'll go to that peacock version. Or there's another version that I have a YouTube video out there on called the Pleva Perdigon that was one that I picked up in Bosnia when we were there in 2015. That's a really imitative version, even though it still has a hot spot. It's a great fly when there are a lot of Betis around. So good tailwater version, you know. Really, I like to guess and check a lot. That's really kind of what it comes down to. So I have maybe, you know, half a dozen go-to colors that I might go to regularly in between. And just, you know, if you got a piece of water in front of you that you know has fish and you think you should be catching fish in there and you're just not, flip a color real quick, see what happens. And you'd be surprised a lot of times what happens. I was on a really famous hard fish tailwater in Oregon this last year in May. And there's loads and loads of Betis and midges in this river. And so I was fishing a dark peacock version of it thinking, oh yeah, this is going to be the one they're going to want. I've caught many, many trout in that river formerly on, you know, dark midge and Betis type patterns. I was catching a few fish on them, but not really what I expected. And I, before the trip, for some silly reason, had tied up an all white version with some, with a pearl rib on it. And, I just was like, well, let's see, you know. I put it on, and I ended up getting like 9 or 10 fish in the next 2 hours on that one white version. So I guess it's just kind of the inquisitiveness in me. Maybe it's just because I'm such a poor fisherman that I don't have a system for something like that. I don't know. But really what has kind of gotten me the color variations of any fly that I use over the years that I'm most confident in has been trial and error. And So I wish I had a magic bullet there for you, Tim, where you, it would get you quicker to the exact variation.
I just wanted to peek in the mind of Devin.
He's got an app.
Yeah. That app isn't worth much.
That's why it's free.
I'm probably paying you to take that app. Okay, so to finish off this fly, I think it's probably dry enough by now that I do this. But obviously, yeah.
Why do you put the wing case on the bottom?
Okay, so there again, especially if you were fishing this as a jig hook, you would still do the same thing. A lot of people have asked me that question over the years. Why wouldn't you put it on the belly so that it goes side up? So I've watched a lot of video of insects underwater, and the one thing you're going to see is that they're not always riding right side up in the water. In fact, much of the time they're inverted. Most of the time they're totally helter-skelter. So with a small mayfly net, especially, you know, your crawlers and clingers that are really poor swimmers, frankly, but their strength is staying glued to a rock, right? Well, the minute they get lost on that rock, all of a sudden they're not very good at riding themselves. And so when you're in pocket water or really any current with turbulence, those nymphs aren't staying perfectly upright and, you know, just drifting along in a nice position. They're tumbling, they're turning over, all sorts of stuff like that. So it doesn't really matter, most likely, because that fly is going to get turned in the current and show it to the fish and not, and show it to the fish and not as it's drifting. The other thing that I've kind of thought about with this too is if your fly is inverted and you're doing, whether you're fishing an indicator rig or a Euro nymph rig, your leader is going to have a slight downstream angle from your flies up to your cider or your indicator, right? So that fly is drifting, if it's upside down, it's drifting with that wing case facing downriver, if you think about it that way. Well, that's the side you want facing a fish since it's looking upstream at it, if you actually want to show them that wing case, right? So that's another reason to put it on whatever side of the fly you think is going to be actually the bottom, because as it flips and is riding downstream, that's the side that actually gets shown to the fish. So that's kind of my thought process on that. And I've actually talked to I wrote a blog post about that a while back because I got a guy blown up on YouTube about it with me, the same question, but in a less nice manner, right? And some of the Spanish competitors read my post and they're like, yeah, that's exactly what we were thinking when you did that. And so I guess that's a good line of thought to be in since they've been double world champions the last couple of years. So. So yeah, that's kind of my thought process on why I put the wing case on the back. All right. So now to finish the fly, I've just got some UV resin here. It's nice to have a bodkin handy, depending upon the applicator that you have, to make sure you get the right smoothness to the body that you want. But I've gone ahead and spun it around. If you have a brush like this, I just kind of take the shaft of the brush and get any excess off. And this one actually looks pretty good without it. But if you have lumps or it settles to one side or the other, you can use the bodkin to smooth that shape back on out. And then just hit it. And I don't know how well it shows up on... Yeah, it shows up pretty well on the camera. When you hit it with that UV light, you can see just how bright that fluorescent orange thread is. It really glows. So I like that a lot. But there you go. So this fly originally, the fluorescent orange version, my buddy Luis called the Butano. And so I still kind of call this pattern the, you know, if it's a Perdigone that I tie with Crystal Flash, as an ode to him, I call it the Butano. Even though translated, it was like gasoline or like a butane, you know, Perdigone. That's why the orange one originally was called the Butano. I still call it that, even though there's a bunch of color variations that have nothing to do with butane, like the original orange. But. All right, there you go.
It won't work, Devin.
What's that?
It won't work if you change it.
It won't, you know?
In my experience, you got to follow the rules.
Got to keep the naming convention.
Yep.
It's the fishiness is in the name as much as the pattern,
unfortunately,
right?
Unfortunately, that just won't work.
Okay. Well, I think my time with the vice is done. Who's up next?
Hey, Lance.
Yeah, I did a terrible blowtorch, but that's okay. Do you want me to leave any of this up here?
No, there you go.
Okay.
If not,
all right.
All right.
Let's try and take some of this crap.
My focus tool.
Okay. So maybe you're wondering why I'm up here. I'm not Devin or Lance. I'm not a competitive angler. I think I'd enjoy it if I did. But
you're not yet. Got more ninja skills than most people in this world.
I don't know about
that's
that.
True. He did. We had a little modern nymphing celebratory party on the river today, and he did just fine. Don't let him convince you otherwise.
But because of these guys, a couple of things. With the patterns that I like to tie, and I'm pretty sure Devin and Lance definitely agree with this, the simpler the better, right, as long as they're going to catch fish. As a guide, a lot of times I don't have time to tie a very complicated pattern, so it's nice to keep them simple, especially when you're in a hurry, like in the summer times and that. So first fly that I'm going to tie up, I'm going to tie up one of Lance's patterns, actually. It's on our confidence fly sheet. It's a tungsten surveyor. So in the vise, I've got a Hens 254, which is a lot like the Hanuck 230. Barbless, we've got a silver this is a 3mm bead, I believe, with 5, 6, 7 wraps of 15/1000 lead wire. Okay, so we're going to take some 8-aught red thread. Secure that lead wire in a little bit. For the tail material, I'm also going to use Coctivion. My favorite thing that I like about this material is that it's very, very durable. I know Devin mentioned that.